Hello everyone, my name is JCRP and you're watching Kalakar Makerspace videos. In today's video, we will be seeing how we can finish plywood and MDF. I will be staining the plywood and the MDF and we will try to get some output like this. This was carved using our CNC machine and then I have finished it using stain and some other materials which I will explain detail in this video. So let's go inside the video and see how I reached this place. I begin the project by CNCing the part out. This is 18mm plywood and I'm using a ball nose bit to carve out the design. The design that I'm going for is a plate design and this is a kind of cheap plywood and I wanted to test out this possibility, so I use this. Now you can cut the shape using a 4mm milling bit and you can see the total shape how it has come out. This entire carving process took about 1.5 hours. Once the carving is done, we can take the piece out. If you see, because it's of cheap quality plywood, there are a lot of fibers that has come out and the cutting is not nearly perfect. But we can fix this in the sanding process. That's the next process. Here you can see the close-up look. While sanding, we are removing the top brown layer. This is the finishing layer that every plywood has, but for my taste this was not absolutely necessary. So using a 40 grit sandpaper, I'm going rough with the surface and removing all the brown parts. Once all the brown plywood is removed, this looks much better. To avoid splitting, I take it to the router and using a chamfer bit, I chamfer the edges. I just give a little bit of chamfer so that I can still pick it up and hold it comfortably, but at the same time, there is no more splitting happening on the edges. Because it's plywood, it's bound to do that and chamfering will definitely reduce that. Here is a close-up look of all the fibers that has been lifted out. And you can see a lot of voids also inside the plywood, and that's mainly because it's of the cheap kind. If I had used birch plywood, it would have been much better, but for the first try it's perfectly fine and it's good to work with the worst also so that we can see what we can do best. Starting from 60 grit sandpaper, I remove all the fibers and I go up till 220 grit. Because it's a curved surface, I cannot use the machine over here, so it's all about hand sanding. It took me at least an hour to sand all the pieces down to its final grit. Once the sanding is done, you can see all the fibers have been gone, but still the voids are over there. And to fill that up, that's the next step. But you can see that the sanding has done a good job about removing every bit of the fiber. To fill the gaps, we are going to use this wood filler from Asian Paints. This is a thinner based wood filler, which means it dries very fast. So I take a small quantity and then stain the wood. Because this plywood is of beige color, or we can say a little bit of cream color, I want to get this putty into the same color. So I mix a little bit of brown. This is actually walnut brown stain from Asian Paints. I mix that well, and once I mix it, I bring the plywood near it to actually test if the color matches. I make sure that I mix it really well so that there are no white stains left still in the piece. You can see that the plywood matches really well with the putty. Again, because it's a complicated shape, we cannot use the metal strips to apply putty. So I'm using my hand to fill in the voids. I take a good amount of putty and then push it deep inside the voids so that it fills all the grains and the gaps. I actually overdid this job, and you can see I have coated the entire surface with putty. Now this is a problem because now I have to again sand everything out, starting from 40 grit up to 320 grit. And by sanding I mean that I have to take out every surface of putty outside, so the remaining piece actually looks like wood, but all the grains and all the voids are filled with putty. I know this is too much, just don't do it too much of putty work, otherwise the sanding process will take so much of time, but you can learn from a mistake. After sanding, you can see all the voids filled, and there is not much of a color difference because I had already stained the putty. Now we can keep this piece aside and go ahead and take a look at the MDF, which is our next piece. And here's the MDF. I carved it out using the same process, and you can see the carving lines over there. So in the next step I did the sanding, which I did not show you here, but I sanded the entire piece out properly before going to the next step. And in the next step I'm using Asian Paints epoxy. By the way, this is not a product sponsor of Asian Paints. I just use this products and I'm showing it to you here so that it will be helpful. This epoxy is a two-part epoxy and it is completely clear. It is almost like water. It takes about 20 minutes to completely dry, and it's a 1:1 ratio epoxy. So if you mix 50 grams of part A, then you have to mix 50 grams of part B, and then stir it well and use it immediately because it starts hardening very quickly. I use an old brush to apply the epoxy on the MDF, and you can see the MDF just pulling in all the epoxy, and that's the whole purpose of using this epoxy, because in the next process when I'm actually staining the MDF, it shouldn't drink a lot of stain. So the epoxy actually seals all the fibers and makes the outer surface really like a hard shell so that the sanding can be done really smooth. The alternate to this is using a sanding sealer, but I prefer epoxy better because it sands well and gives a really smooth finish. Here you can see after the epoxy has dried up, it almost looks like pure MDF, but when you sand it gives a white dust, and that's how well this epoxy sands, and I really like that. I go ahead and sand up to 400 grit. After sanding the entire piece, this is how it actually looks. You can see the entire MDF has become white in color. That's because we have sanded all the surface including the back. Now we can go ahead and stain. First we'll stain the plywood. To stain that, we are using a little bit of rosewood and thinning out with NC thinner. Do not use turpentine, please use thinner so that it dries faster. First I apply along the grains slowly so that I give the time for the wood to pull in all the stain. And here is a sped up process where I show you how I apply the stain. The first coat should always be more because the wood is definitely going to drink in a lot of material, so it's okay if you use a bit more over here. And this is just the first coat that you're seeing. I went ahead and coated it 3-4 times, making the color more and more darker with each coat. For the MDF, I used a walnut color because I wanted to go for a brown look. Again, I thinned it out with the NC thinner. And I personally liked this finish much better than the rose wood finish. The brown actually makes it feel like it's real wood. And the quality of MDF also matters. The MDF that I used is from Century and they give really good output. If you use any other material, then the fibers in the MDF are different and it does not give a great output. So I stain the MDF pieces also 4-5 times, making the color darker, And after that is done, I am going to coat the final surface with the water-based PU. That's the Aquador water-based PU that you saw. Water-based is because this is going to be used as a serving plate on which we're going to keep food materials. The water-based one is a little better. So once it actually completely cures, it does not have any toxic material. I prefer using water-based finish on things on which food is going to be kept. I used a matte finish, and you can see how the matte finish is. It's a little bit glossy because it's still drying. But here you can see the plywood. I really like the texture of white and rose here. It's come out really, really well. I love this piece. And you can see all the other pieces that I've dried. So you must have understood by now that finishing the MDF involves a lot of sanding, and particularly there are a few materials that you need, but it is really not tough. I hope this video was useful for you, and if you have any questions, please put them in the comments. I hope to see you in the next Friday project video, and all the links that you need to follow are in the description. Until next time, happy learning!